there. I just want to speak the name of Jesus till every dark addiction starts to break. Declaring there is hope and there is freedom, I speak Jesus. And that just really sat with me this morning, because too many of us, and so many of us, are afraid to give everything to Jesus. And without giving everything to Jesus, we don't experience that hope and we don't experience that freedom. Because we're too afraid to actually say, Lord, no longer I, but you. And I've touched on this passage before. Just this one verse. If you walk into my office, on my wall, as you walk in, there's a picture my daughter drew and there's a picture my other daughter gave me. And it says, 2 Timothy 1 verse 7, I do not have a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. And I've held that into my heart as a Christian ever since I got saved. I do not have a spirit of fear. Because the world, the way the demonic world kind of works is to instill fear in us. So we don't come to the place of saying, not I, but you. Because we're scared to give up, in a way, our kind of identity. We're scared to give up our independence. Yeah, can I really trust Jesus? So I ask again, who is Jesus to you? Can you say, I'm living without fear? I don't think any of us really can. But it's a challenge for us when we come to this verse to be able to say, I do not have the spirit of fear. Because God has told me I belong to him. And he will be with me until the end of the age. Do we grasp that? Now we read Matthew 28, so easy. Go and make disciples and baptize them. And I will be with you till the end of the age. Does that actually settle into our hearts and our mind that he is with us? Even now, as you sit here, he is with you by his spirit. That the Holy Spirit is within each of us that have called him Lord. His spirit sits in us. And I can say truly this morning, I do not have a spirit of fear. That doesn't mean I'm not wary of things. Does not mean I'm not cautious. But it does mean that in my spirit, I'm not afraid of the things of this world. Because fear debilitates us. Fear makes us, virtually when we get to a place, we say, I'm not going there because I'm afraid of what is behind that. I never realized years ago, I found out, do you know how high a springbok can jump? They can jump high. But if you go to the zoo, the wall is only this high. And I've thought to myself, why don't they jump over the wall and run away? Do you know why they don't? Because they don't know what's on the other side. If you put a clear fence, they're gone. But they just put a wall. Just a low wall, enough that the springbok cannot see over. And fear keeps them bound in their little crawl for their whole lives. And there are many of us sitting here this morning that are stuck in this little crawl of our whole lives because we haven't got the, I don't want to use the word gumption, but I will. The gumption to get up and say, not me, but you, Lord. I will go forward because I do not have a spirit of fear. I will take this thing on, whatever it is. It might be that dark addiction. It might be that I live without hope, but I will take it on because you are with me. You are with me always, in the darkest and in the lightest. I am with you. I will be with you. And so as I read this passage in 2 Timothy 1 verse 7, as Timothy's getting this message, remember Timothy's a young man. Timothy's going in to deal with elders as I am because of my disobedience. But Timothy has to go and deal with elders and he has to come in as a young man. And you know, in that culture, a young man speaking into an older man's life was not on. But he would have to go to the elders and deal with them. And so what has been written to him is, you do not have a spirit of fear, Timothy. What it actually means, that word fear there is, Timothy, you do not have a spirit of anxiety and you do not have a spirit of cowardice. That's even harsher than you don't have a spirit of fear. The word is delias, cowardice. And that's quite a harsh word to us as Christians to say, are you a coward? By not taking that step forward, by not taking that next step in your faith, by not moving forward in hope. Because if you do not go forward, what you're actually saying is, Lord, you're not with me. Lord, you're insufficient. Lord, I cannot do this because you're not with me. The moment you're doing that, you're saying, Jesus, you're not sufficient. I want to do it in my own strength. And then the fear comes in. And the fear begins to slowly work in our lives. And it moves, even as Christians, the cycle works in our lives. Written in the top of my Bible, and I've read it so many times, with fear comes inadequacy. I'm not sufficient. I cannot do this. I'm inadequate. I'm inadequate as a husband. I'm inadequate as a wife, as a parent, as a child, as a boss, as an employee, whatever. That fear of it moves slowly and it permeates and it eats and it eats and it eats. And this inadequacy comes in. I'm not sufficient. And as that comes in, weakness. A spiritual weakness, sometimes even a physical weakness. There's a mental weakness that comes in. And slowly we continue down this dark path of fear, of anxiety, and ultimately of cowardice. How many of us here have struggled all our lives with low self-esteem? Many. Because of what people have said to us, how people have treated us. Maybe husbands feel like it. Maybe wives, maybe children speaking to their lives. And slowly this moves on and we become weak. And then our self-esteem starts to struggle. And with that comes inferiority. I'm not the same as them. They're better than me. I'll just take a back seat. And then slowly comes the real bad one. Rejection. Fear causes such rejection in us. Because fear tells me that I don't know who I am. Fear says to me, Barry, you don't belong. Fear says to me, Barry, you're inadequate. Fear says to me when I'm sitting there, when the Lord says, Barry, I think I need you to speak, or not, I think I need you to speak on something. I want you to speak on this. Fear says, Lord, I can't. Fear says, Lord, I'm inadequate. Lord, what happens if I say something stupid? I think he's big enough to deal with it. What happens if I say something wrong? I think I can deal with it, Barry. All I'm asking is for you to do it. Because I'm with you. You know what you're talking about. You're talking about me. I speak Jesus. And so this fear moves into to reject. I lived my whole life with rejection till I got saved. Of not being adequate for my parents. How many of you sitting right here, and I actually should say to you, put your hand up. That is feeling like you rejected. Some people put their hands up attentively. But it's a big issue in our lives. And many times we don't know that we feel rejected. Because the evil one is very subtle in the way he masks what we see. He hides it from you. So you keep operating in the darkness. You keep operating in the weakness. You keep operating in the low self-esteem and the inferiority complex. And the rejection gets deeper and deeper and becomes more bitter and more sour. Till eventually there's a problem. And the worst thing for me ever is when Christians take their own lives. And that happens. And then I have two questions to ask. Firstly, where was your faith in Jesus? But I also ask, where was the rest of the church? That Christians would get so far to where they take their own lives because nobody has come alongside them. Maybe we don't know because some people are very quiet about their struggle, but we can see it. How can a Christian do that? How can anybody do it? But if you profess Christ, how can the darkness become so dark that it overtakes hope? The world is hopeless. We are not. I have a future. Yes, and the future on earth might be a struggle. I might look like a raccoon or a panda. I was told next door, you look like a monkey. Luckily, I don't have rejection issues anymore. But, friends, we need to be moving on in our faith to say, I do not have a spirit of fear. Darkness, you will not govern me. I will beat you. Not in my own strength, but I speak Jesus. I speak Jesus and I claim the hope. Not the health and wealth brigade. I claim I will be healthy. No. I claim the hope of Christ. Christ alone will be my strength, will be my sufficiency. I'm not afraid to step into the territory that is held by the evil one. As frightening as it is. If you step into the evil one's territory and you're not frightened, you need to take a step back. But we need to step anyway. Because I'm not afraid. I have everything that I need. As I look around, yeah, I can see you now. Interestingly. As I look at you, I wonder how many sitting here right now are afraid to take just that one step. That proverb, every journey starts with one step. The biggest fear is taking that step. Because once you get going, it's easier to lift the next foot. But to take that one step of saying, it's time. It's time for me to step out of the darkness, to claim the hope, claim the promises of Christ, and to walk into a fullness of joy. Darkness makes us unhappy. Fear robs us of our joy. Are you afraid this morning? What are you afraid of? I want to do something. This is again, I said to the guys before the meeting this morning, I don't know what's going to happen this morning. We'll do what we planned. If you're struggling with fear, there's something that has got a hold over you right now that you're afraid to step up and say, so far and no further. Lord, I'm going to claim your promises for me right now. These promises are yes and amen. Yes, you can, and amen. I have said it. Let it be so. So, Barry. You are welcome to. Barry and Barry, this is like a dual double act. Where's number three?
Yeah, I struggled with that song today because I thought I need to share, and he has my opportunity. Peter Jade has borderline personality disorder, and we had no cooking clue what it was. But after a number of suicide attempts, I was scared to go into her bedroom. I was scared to wake her. I was scared to open that door in case she had taken an overdose and was lying dead in her bed. And how would I deal with that? And we would sing that song looking in that direction, and we would sing that song, I'm no longer afraid of fear. And I was meeting with the pastor at the Hill Presbyterian Church, and I was telling him of the struggle that I had. I'm a believer, and yet I was scared. PTSD is a real thing. I mean, we live with it in our family. And he said, so I shared what was going on in our lives. And he said, I'm preaching on fear in church tomorrow. Can I use your testimony as an example? And it's a very real thing. And maybe you today are me a year ago. That whatever you're afraid of, whatever has got you, has got you. And you can't let go. You can't let go in your own strength. And we did a course online, and I came to understand the term radical acceptance. If you walk outside today and you're wanting to go on a picnic and it's raining, there's actually nothing you can do. It's raining. You can't stop the rain. There's nothing you can do. And you actually have to accept that that's the fact. And that's where I got peace, is when I accepted the fact that Peter Jade's life is out of my hands. There's nothing I can do. And so maybe today you need a push, a nudge. It's out of your hands if you give it to him.
Amen. Thank you, Barry. So I'm going to challenge you. If you are afraid of something right now that's holding you back from life, I want to ask you to come to the front. I'm going to ask you just to stand up. Don't worry about people around you. If nobody stands, that's fine. But there are people standing already. If there's something holding you back, that it's got you in its clutches, I want to pray for you. Because whatever it is, you can beat it. You might have to live with it for a while, but you can beat it. Let's just pray for them. If there's somebody next to you, maybe just lay a hand on them. Woman on woman, please, or men, be careful. Let's just pray for them. Lord, I pray that your word, I do not have a spirit of fear, would settle into the hearts of those who are standing. More than that, I pray that your word would settle into the hearts of those who are too afraid to stand. Lord, we don't want them to stand so we can see that they're afraid. We want them to stand as a recognition that you are capable, that you are able, but also to encourage us that we are not alone in our struggles. We all think our struggles are unique, but we all hurt. We all struggle. And thank you that the one thing that we can all call on, the one refuge, the one rock we have is you. Thank you that we are able to speak the name of Jesus in truth and in power and in love for those who are struggling. I pray for each one this morning that is struggling with some sort of fear or anxiety, that Holy Spirit, you would do a wondrous work, that you would break that darkness that has a hold over them. Not just break it down that it's still lying around, but shatter it to have no hold whatsoever. That those that have been freed from that fear would be able to testify, God is good. Lord, I pray that you would be honored in this. That it's not for our glory, but for yours alone. You are the one who destroys fear. Do not be afraid. I am with you. Do not be discouraged. I am with you. You will not have to fight this battle. I am with you. Lord, so I just commit each one of them to you. I pray that they would not even be afraid to share it afterwards with somebody. Just to ask for somebody else to pray with them or walk a road or whatever it is. Thank you that we can ask you for this. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I do not have a spirit of fear. We pray that as you pray that God would break that for you and bring you peace. See, because with that struggle with fear, God doesn't just say to us as he writes through Paul to Timothy, you do not have a spirit of fear, now go out and do it. He also says, you do not have a spirit of fear, you have power. You have power. His power to do it. So when you open up that word power, that dunamis, it actually has two connotations. One that is absolute power, ability, and one that says royal power, kingly power. So I'm part of the royal house of Jesus. Do you know that? So are you. If we are heirs to the kingdom of heaven, then we fall into that category and we have this royal blood flowing in us by the power of the Spirit. And so I'm able to say, I have the power of the King. Because the Son has the power of the Father. And he has said to us, I have given it to you. And so I don't have to walk in the spirit of fear. I can walk in the spirit of power. Because it's his power given to me. And I use it according to his principles and what he wants. Not what we see so much on TV, but in the power of God to bring about salvation, to bring about healing and redemption and reconciliation and atonement. And we just keep going. That's what we use that power for. So I have this kingly power. I also have this dunamis power, this power of ability. What he's saying to me is, Barry, if you are afraid, you can step out of it. Because I've given you the power to do that. Not in your own strength, but by the Holy Spirit that lives within us. The full Holy Spirit. Don't come and think, well, you know, I've just got saved. So I've just got a little bit of the Spirit. It will grow over time and then I will deal with my issue. The moment you come to Christ, you're filled with the full Holy Spirit to help you. I've shared this with you before, but let's keep it right in our minds. Men and women and children do not have different Holy Spirits. Little people don't get little Holy Spirits. And women don't get female Holy Spirits. We all get the same. The third part of the triune God. To empower us, to equip us, to do what we need to do in breaking the fear in our lives. To be able to walk out of the darkness into his marvelous light. That should be something we desire every day of our lives. How do I do that? I yield. I yield to Christ. Not my will, but yours. Jesus gave us the ultimate picture of what it means to yield, what it means to submit for his power to work through. Dad, not my will, but yours. And here we are because of that. I don't have a spirit of fear. I have a spirit of power. to do what I need to do. So if you're sitting here today and God is stirring you and saying to you, I want you to do this and you're not doing it, be careful. It's disobedience. I don't want to use the term, you might walk out here today and get hit by a bus. But you could. There's a taxi that comes down this road every morning about 5 to 8. Make sure you're not in the road. But it's a reality. Today is the day of your salvation. Hallelujah. We're not guaranteed tomorrow. Hallelujah. Make the choice. I do not have a spirit of fear. Rob, you're going to come. Who stole the mic? Yeah.
My voice doesn't carry.
I'll just put the mic in front of you.
Okay. Going on what you said, the spirit of suicide. 4 Wednesdays ago, I hit rock bottom. And I know God, I know who they are. I just had a moment in my life where I've had enough. And yes, I'm part of a cell and everything. I just felt like I was alone. And that Wednesday night, I actually declared what was going on. I said to my soul, I said, this is where I am, this is what I had. My wrist is clean now. I had cuts going all the way down my spine. I know the proper way to commit suicide. We had an English teacher that was also a life skill teacher. He said, don't waste our time. Do it that way. And I just didn't do that way. But just to let you know, the soul groups that you have, the life groups that you have, they are there to lift you up totally. And the walk I've walked on when I was 5 to when I was a teenager, I was sexually abused by people. Not just one person, people at school. And I had no one to talk to. And the lie of the enemy was, you have to keep quiet. Don't tell anybody. It's not for the world to know. It's just between you and me. The devil's got this button. He turns it very slowly. Jesus is amazing. He wants to get you to heaven and believing in him and testifying. But this button turns very slowly. So you don't know that you are sad and alone. Yes, it's always me. Sad and alone, guilty, to do all those type of things. But eventually, with me, 1994 was the first time, eventually I realized there's more to life than feeling sorry, feeling anxious, and that at the moment, because I kept quiet for all those years, I've got stuff that's bubbling out. It's controlling me. My little girl knows all my history. She knows who I am, what I am, where I stand. I mean, to have a gun to your head and a knife to your throat, as well as everything else, as well as losing my mom-in-law here at this beautiful church, and losing my mother to cancer. Those are some of the packages I have to put down. Aren't you, Tracy? The suitcase has to get shut and burnt of all those problems. And I'm on medication now. So if you see me jumping around the church, please forgive me. I most probably haven't taken my medicine. But just to say, this church is a family, and every single one of us, we are going through stuff right now. But there's a verse that my mother-in-law kept on quoting to me. Be still, know he is God. And he is listening. And it's just his timing. I used to teach Sunday school, and I had a watch. I turned the clock over, and the little 5-year-olds, they said, why are you doing that? You have to tell the time. And I said, God's time has no hands. The devil's might, but God's hand has no hands. Thank you.
Thank you, Robin. I do not have a spirit of fear, but of power, to break those things, to stand against those things. And when I'm feeling weak, look around you. Power. Yes. Hope you guys' lunch is simmering.
Sorry, I just want to share a testimony that happened to me as I was in Italy. Just on the 29th of July, I got involved in an accident, and we were driving a motorcycle. I usually don't go in the motorcycle. My friend begged me to go with him, and I follow him. Unfortunately, we got involved in an accident. A car hit us from the back, and we lost the control of the motorcycle, and we end up hitting a pole on the side of the road, and we flew on the pavement. And suddenly, I was lay on the floor and my friend was near me and I was afraid. Afraid because I thought I will never be able to maybe walk again and do the job that I'm supposed to do, that God called me to do in this world. So I fear really struck me. And as I was laying on the floor, my friend was near me, and I realized that my friend protect me. As we bang on the pole, he protect me, and we lay down together on the side of the road there. And some people came and told us not to move, stay there still, because if we move, if we have something broken, it could be very dangerous. So I stayed there. There was nothing I could do, but I start praying, and I lay my hand on my friend that he was in pain, and I pray for him. And the fact that I stopped thinking about myself and thinking about him, it really worked out. I was not afraid anymore. I knew there was a purpose in that crazy, crazy time of my life. I had to be an encouragement to him, and I prayed. Eventually, the ambulance took me to the hospital, and I didn't know about my friend. I end up in the hospital. There were so many people, and I was waiting there, laying on the bed. I have a collar, and I have pain everywhere. Then I asked about my friend. Nobody knew where it was, so I thought maybe he died. So I phoned to his son and asked him, please inquire where is your dad? We had an accident. So he found out that he was in severe pain and he has so many broken bones. So they flew him with the helicopter in another hospital, and they were ready to have surgery. When he arrived, I find out later that the doctor, because he had 17 broken ribs, he had the spine broken in 3 places, and he has a lot of wounded, and he has organ here, they were wounded and bleeding. But the doctor said as soon as he arrived in the hospital, he stopped bleeding, the organ stopped bleeding, so they didn't have to operate. And I believe it was the prayer. So I kept praying, and I say, well, I'm here in this hospital. Maybe God put me here for a reason. So I start witness. There was I couldn't move. There was a lady near me. She was 80 years old, something. She was in pain. And I told her about Jesus, and she prayed and accept Jesus. So for me, was the best way to face fear is just to know that we have Jesus and we can be a witness in whatever situation you are. Whatever is the outcome, God protect me, because yes, I have some stitches on my foot, but amazingly, the doctor said you don't have anything broken. So that's why I'm standing here today, and I was able to give God the glory. My friend, unfortunately, he's still recovering. We can pray for him. But for me, the best way to face fear is just don't think about yourself, think about others, and start witness. Because wherever we are, and wherever is the condition, we have a job to do. We have missionary. We have Jesus. This world, when I found myself in the hospital, it was a nightmare. There was so many people, and people in bad condition. Did they know Jesus? Well, we have a responsibility to tell them. So I want to give God the glory. That doesn't mean that God can protect us all the time. But even if he doesn't protect us, he's with us. And we have a purpose in every situation we have. So I overcame fear, and thank you so much for the people that pray for me. And I want to give God the glory for what's happened.
Amen. Thank you. I'm honored. thought you were coming up, Keith. I don't have a spirit of fear. I have a spirit of power. I have a spirit of love. And we are each given that portion, that agape love. That's the word that is used here, that love of God. It's not phileo love. It's not eros love. We know there's three kinds, phileo being a friendship love, eros being a kind of intimate sexual love, and but there's an agape love or agape, however you want to pronounce it, this love that only God can give us. This love for each other. I think that's what in a way Romano is saying to us, to pray for that man is not about me, it's about him. It's about him being healed. It's that love being transferred from us to them. The love of God being transferred from him to us. I have that thing. As hard as it is to love people, that is what we are called to. And God equips us in the most difficult situation to be that person that loves. And then he says to us, you have a spirit not of power and of love and of a sound mind. Now that is one of the biggest places where the devil will attack you, is in your mind. Because this is where everything happens. We know it even says in the word, sin begins in the mind and then moves to the heart and is the action of the hands and the direction of the feet. But if we can deal with our minds first, that is where the problem begins. Fear is a manifestation in our heads. And often we see things that actually aren't there. And it builds. So God says to us, we do not have a spirit of this fear, but we have a sound mind to reason. Faith is also reasoning. Faith is not just, I just believe stuff. Faith is also understanding God's word and knowing what he says to say, I believe what it says. How many of you were here the day I tore the pages out of the so-called Bible and shocked you? We either have to believe it all or none of it. So if I have this sound mind, it means if I want to defeat my fear, if I want to work in the power that God gives me, I want to operate in this circle of love, then firstly, I must know God's word. So many people are struggling because they don't know what God says. And then we have these false churches and false preachers that preach nonsense, so people still don't know what the Bible says. We need to dig ourselves into the word. Every moment that we can, we should be looking at God's word. I should challenge you now and say, how many of you have got your Bibles here? Don't want to embarrass you. Heather's got hers, it's there. If our Bible is our sword, Ephesians 6, the sword of the Spirit, this is what we fight with, that book. We need to know that if we're going to have the power and the love and defeat our anxiety and our fear. We've got to study God's word. It's got to sink into our bones. How do we defend ourselves when the devil says, but doesn't it say this? We can say, no, the word says this. There'll be many times if you know God's word, you might get into a situation. You don't know where it is in the Bible, but you know it's there. I'm so saddened. There's a very well-known preacher right now. I tell you, his name is Andy Stanley. And he's saying that we should no longer use the Bible. That is heresy. That is shocking. The Bible is the basic instruction before leaving earth. The Bible is our book. The Bible has got our truth. If we're not quoting the Bible or learning the scripture, what are we going to learn? What are we going to stand on? Some airy-fairy nonsense? Or the word of God? We must know the word from in the beginning to amen. All of it. Not just the New Testament, not just the letters we like, everything. Even the Old Testament. We must learn it. And watch God's. Hopefully next week, I want to preach next week around Christ-focused. That scarlet thread running through Scripture that is Jesus. But we need to know God's Word. And when you begin to study God's Word, our mind begins to look at that Word and transform it into our bodies and it says, I know who I am. Do you know who you are? Where is your identity found this morning? If you're sitting here, is your identity found in your wife? Is your identity found in your husband or your friend or your children? That's in the wrong thing. We cannot find our identity in created things. We find our identity in the creator of things. That is Jesus. That is who I am. I'm a child of the living God, an heir to the throne. Do you believe that? See, if you don't believe that, then that series of weakness and low self-esteem and rejection takes root. No, I'm not that. You should be able to quote Romans 8 by 8 by now. I share it so often. There's no condemnation. No one can charge me. No one can put anything against me because I cannot be separated from the love of God found in Christ Jesus. Nothing will separate me from that. That's my identity. I'm a child of God. I challenged you this morning. Can you say that this morning? See, if you can't say that, then you're going to struggle with fear. You're going to struggle to take that step. You're going to struggle to get to that wall and say, let me look over it and see what's on the other side. We must know our identity. Our identity comes through our salvation, through the power of the Spirit in us, and then through the bringing of the Word. Are you being led by the Spirit? That's one of the big problems we have in our denomination as a church affiliation, is that we don't teach enough on the Holy Spirit. Amen. We should be, I'm saying, all the time looking at the Word, looking at the Father, the Son, being empowered by the Spirit, working in our gifting. Allowing the Spirit to lead us and guide us and equip us and empower us. But we rather lock him in a cupboard. Because when people get going in the Holy Spirit, it's embarrassing. It is embarrassing for some because they act like lunatics. That's not what the Holy Spirit does. The Holy Spirit glorifies God. Amen. So whatever we do in the Spirit is a glory to him. It's always got to be like that. I pray that even as I'm sharing with you, it's by the power of the Holy Spirit. Not for me, for you. So that God's word is declared to bring you victory. As it's bringing me. As I share this, it's talking to me too. Are you being led by the Spirit in your journey? And how do we know that the Spirit's working with us? How do we talk to the Spirit? Well, we've got to go with the word. And we've got to pray. The biggest weakness in the modern church, we don't pray. And I know it's one of my weaknesses. When I don't pray, I'm not connected. When I pray, as Andrew Murray says, I'm practicing the presence of God. When I come to pray, it's God and I sitting down saying, let's talk. Lord, what do you want from me? Where do you want me to go? What do you want me to do? Lord, I'm struggling with this. Help me. People of prayer. Prayer overcomes so much. I found one of the great things of having mentors in this church that I meet with regularly. Often when there's a challenge, I sit down from them and I say, I'm really struggling with this. Can I share it with you? They say, go for it. By the time I've shared it with them, I've dealt with the problem because I've put it into a logical sequence. And then I work it through. Oh, that's actually quite easy. It's not so big because I've worked it out. Often in our fear and our anxiety, everything is doing this. It's affecting every part of our lives. So we can't think straight. When we come to pray, we sit down and we say, Lord, this is my problem. And do the same thing. Put it in an order. He knows what you're going to say anyway because he knows your problem. Put it, Lord, this is the problem. I'm struggling with this. So, for me, you struggle with alcohol. What's the first step God's going to say to me? Don't go where there's alcohol. Beginning of the journey. But already in your own mind, you know that. But you've got to start that journey somewhere. Sometimes you just got to sit before God and say, this is what I need to do. Help me. Help me. Put somebody in my life that's going to be honest with me. Somebody who's going to take me to a place where these people can help you or these people can help you. We must become people of prayer. We're led by the Spirit. Opening God's word so we can be constantly reminded, I am His and He is mine. Can't tell you where it is in the Bible. Top right-hand corner, right-hand column of my Bible. Moses talks to God. And he says, these are the people you gave me. What are you going to do? And God says, is the arm of the Lord too short to save you? And Moses is put quiet. I said to you this morning, if you're struggling with fear, if you're struggling with anxiety, if you're struggling with how do I love people, how do I keep my mind clear? And I ask you, do you think the arm of the Lord is too short? To save you, to come and just speak into your life, to say to you and help you so far, and no further. I would pray for you today that whatever fear you have, whatever anxiety, God would break it. That you leave this place in victory, in freedom. That doesn't mean your problem is going to go away. But it might mean you need to take some steps. Put some things into place to help you. So we don't do this alone. We have God, we have His Spirit, but we have each other. And we do fall short, sadly, in this department. Paul was so clear. Timothy, you do not have a spirit of fear. Power, love, and a sound mind. Why do we not use them? Why do we not stand up and say, so far and no further? Let me pray for you. If anybody wants prayer, please come up even during this prayer so we can pray for you. I don't want anybody to go home that God hasn't spoken to them. Lord, I just believe this is what you wanted for today. We live in very interesting and very difficult and very challenging times. I don't think there's one home that is represented here that cannot say we do not have a struggle of some sort. Spiritual, emotional, physical, financial, whatever. And so Lord, I just pray, Holy Spirit, that you would minister as only you can. Lord, we can share your word and we can show how to do things, but it's only by your power, by you working in our lives. And so I pray for each of us as we sit here and just think about our lives, the struggles we have, that Lord, your absolute peace, that peace that overcomes all struggle, all fear, would settle upon us. Lord, I'm reminded of your people as those three armies faced them with King Jehoshaphat. They began to sing that God's love endures forever. We are not rejected. We are not alone. And so, Lord, I pray that we would not be afraid, that we would pick up our arms and stand firm. May your word go out this morning. Do not be discouraged. Do not be afraid, for I am with you. Whatever you're facing, whatever you're struggling with, the Lord is saying to you, speak Jesus. The author, perfecter of our faith. The one that called us out of the miry clay onto the rock. So Lord, I just commit your word to you to do what it needs to be done, but also to your people to achieve its good and perfect and pleasing purposes, that you would be glorified, that you would be honored, and that your people would be set free. So to you, Lord, be all the glory, the honor, the dominion and power. Because Lord, you created all things. And by your will, they were created and have their being. And that is us. We are yours. Lord, your arm is not too short. Save us in whatever way we need saving. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Hopefully next week, we'll get to something. Enjoy the week. Please don't run away. Rather, if you're struggling, chat with somebody. Have a cup of coffee with them. Talk about where you're struggling. And if you need prayer, let somebody pray for you. Enjoy your week.